if he never calmed the storm or the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never caused a blinded eye to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought a crippled man to his feet. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he was. Cause even if he never come and done a single miracle, Jesus would have still been God. He'd still been God. He'd still been God. He'd still been God. He's God of the mountains. He's God of the seas. He's God of creation. I know God, and God will never change. I know God, and He always will be God.
He's God when lightning flashes. He's God when thunders roll. He's God way up in heaven. I know God, and God will never change. I know God, and He always will be God.
He's still been God, even if it never calmed the storm on the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never caused a blinded eye to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought a crippled man to his feet. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he was. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he was.
Never come the storm on the raging sea. He'd still been God, even if he never caused a blinded eye to see. He'd still been God, even if he never brought a crippled man to his feet. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he was. It's not about what he did, it's all about who he was. Cause even if he never did a single miracle, Jesus would have still been.
He is God.
Yes.
He's a good God. Amen. He's a loving God. He's a blessing God. Is he not?
Yes.
If he has blessed you in any way this past 7 days, would you stand up? I think that means we're ready to praise him. Amen. If you're breathing, you've been blessed, folks. Amen. If you go back and read the newspaper for the last 7 days, there's some people not breathing anymore. You've been blessed more than they. Amen. God is a good God, and we have so much to be thankful for. If you can hear the sound of my voice this morning, you're blessed, not because I'm speaking, but because you can hear. If you can see this building today, you're blessed because you can still see. You breathe. There's so many things that the Lord does for us every day we just take for granted until they're gone, and then we beg God to restore them. Amen? God is a good God, and I'd just like for us to bow our heads and thank God for his blessings as we prepare our hearts to worship him today. Lord, we are so thankful for your blessings today. Your blessings towards us are innumerable. You do things for us every day of our lives, Lord, that we're not even aware of. So all we can do is say thank you, Lord, for all your many blessings, because we understand today that every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, your word says. From the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That is to say that you're a good God, and you're good all the time. And we appreciate that about you, Lord. Your faithfulness, your goodness, your love towards us. Lord, what a wonderful thing. Just as the sun comes up every single morning, your love for us is constant. And we are so thankful for it today. So we come together today to worship you and to give you praise and to honor you for who you are. Accept the free will offerings of our mouths, we pray today. It's in Christ's name that we ask it. Amen. Amen.
Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Man.
This is an older choir song, or an older song the choir is about to sing. We'd invite you to sing along with us. The words will be on the screen. I can't even walk without you holding my hand, it says. Thought number one would surely be me. I thought I could be everything I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand. Without you holding my hand,
I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high, and the valley's too high.
A lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, and I can't even without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high, and the valley's too high.
Amen. Welcome this morning. Turn your Bibles this morning to Psalm 121. If you have a prayer request this morning, or if you're new to New Life, we ask that you fill out the insert in your bulletin this morning. Put it in the offering bag as it passes by. So good to see you today. Psalm 121 says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in. From this time forth, I love this. From this time forth, that means starting right now. Starting right now. Can we say starting right now? Starting right now, forevermore. Amen. The Lord will preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth. Where does our help come from? From the Lord. Not your checking account, not your job, not who you know, unless it is the Lord. Yes. If you know the Lord, you have help today. Yes. He is our help today. The Lord is our keeper. He is our help this morning. Let's go to our Lord in prayer together this morning as we prepare our hearts to give and worship this morning of an offering. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. How great you are, Lord. We love you today. We desire, Lord, that you would be magnified in this place. We exalt you this morning. Lord, we honor you by acknowledging that you're our help. We're thankful today that you help us in so many ways. Help us, Lord, to lift our eyes unto you, to look upon you, the all-powerful God, the all-knowing God who knows all of our needs, all of our cares. Lord, we come under your protection today. Lord, we come, Lord, into your place of refuge this morning. Lord, counting on you, depending upon you. Lord, we offer this praise this morning through giving. We desire, Lord, that you would receive it, that it would be pleasing unto you. For your glory, Lord, we give. In Jesus' name, amen.
There is power, power, wonder working.
As we turn our hearts to the Word in just a few moments, and to, as we announced last week, some of the documents of our country, our forefathers, and just to kind of demonstrate where our country came from and what was on the minds of our forefathers, we'll talk about that a bit today. Let's, before we do that, sing this wonderful old hymn, God Bless America. To bless America. You might be seated. Now, if we were in another country, we might be singing God Bless whatever that country is. But the song says, my home, sweet home. This is where we live. And so we want this country to honor God, and we want things to go well here. And last Sunday, I had the opportunity to share with you some scripture, as well as some other things, quite frankly, that I thought were very important, and we shared how that this country in which we live has a form of government that is known as a democracy. That is, that we play a part in our government. We have a say in our government. We have representation in our government through the vote that we have when elections come around. This is not a monarchy where there's one person rules. This is not an oligarchy where rulership is in the hands of just six or eight men, but this is a democracy, and we all have the opportunity to participate in the form of government which we have in this country. So this morning, and incidentally, for those of you who weren't here last Sunday, we ended our service with an invitation. An invitation to register to vote. And several people took advantage of that and have registered to vote. I know that because I mailed them in and prepared that to go into the post office, as well as others took them home with you. And I trust that you sent those back in before Friday of this past week, because it is extremely important that we become involved, that Christians be salt and light in this culture in which we live. We need to speak up. We need to shine. We need to participate. We need to be salt and make a difference in our culture. And that's what that's all about. So we thank you for your participation there last Sunday. But as stated, today I wanted to look into some documents from United States history. Primarily, it's not because I have this burning desire to talk about politics. That's not the point. But I want us to be reminded. I don't know that I'll share a single thing today that you didn't already know. I don't know that I will. It's possible, I guess. But I think sometimes we need to be reminded. We need to be reminded of how this country of ours came up, how it developed, what was in the minds of our forefathers. And today we'll do that by looking at several documents that you will, I'm sure, recall having heard about, if not since you were in elementary school or perhaps middle school. May have been that long since you heard these things talked about. But we want to remind us today of how blessed we are. And if we understand how our country was founded and the principles and the things that were important to our forefathers, that also helps us go to the next level and understand how in many ways we're departing from that today and how we need to come back to our roots in America. I'm first going to share with you in a moment about a document called the Mayflower Compact. Now, having sailed from England and been on the sea for 66 days, can you imagine that? 66 days on the water, bobbing up and down and back and forth. And I don't even need to explain what would happen to many of us if we were on a boat like that. 66 days. After they had completed their journey and before the pilgrims departed for land, while they were still on the ship, after 66 days on the water, the pilgrims on November the 11th, 1620, decided that they needed, when they departed from the boat and went to this new land, they needed to maintain order and establish a civil society. So all the male passengers on board got together, drafted what I'm about to read to you, and signed their names. I'm going to read the first couple paragraphs or two in the Mayflower Compact, and I have on the screen already what I'd really like for us to extract from that as far as our understanding this morning. The Mayflower Compact begins this way. In the name of God, amen. Well, that's pretty good right there. That's a good start, amen? When you want to do something, you're embarking on something that's very important. Their very first words in the Mayflower Compact were, in the name of God, amen. We whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign Lord King James, by the grace of God of Great Britain, France, and Ireland, Ireland King, Defender of the Faith, etc. I thought it was interesting how they put etc. in a document like that. I guess they'd said so much about how great the king was, they just figured they wouldn't stop, and they put etc. And that way, maybe it would satisfy him. And then the next paragraph begins this way. Having undertaken for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith, isn't that a great sentence? To explain why they had done what they did. Now, let me just pause for a minute, time out. I hadn't thought about this before until this very moment. But we need to understand that there is something going on in America today called historical revisionism. And they're rewriting history. And they're taking everything that has to do with God out of our history and then teaching what's left to our children as if God had nothing to do with it. And I'm going to share with you this morning that God had a lot to do with it. And what they did because of God and their love for God. And so they began the Mayflower Compact with these words, "In the name of God, amen, so be it." And then continued, "Having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith and honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another, covenant, and combine ourselves together in a civil body politic for our better ordering and preservation and furtherance of the ends aforesaid, and by virtue hereof to enact and constitute and frame such just and equal laws, ordinances, acts, constitutions, and offices from time to time as shall be thought most meet and convenient for the general good of the colony, unto which we promise all due submission and obedience." Do we understand today that there can be no order unless there's order? Does that make sense? You have to decide, you have to lay the law down. You have to establish some guidelines. You have to have some principles. It's the last verse, I believe, in the book of Judges, if my mind serves me correctly. "And every man did what was right in his own eyes." But I've got news for you. When every man does what's right in his own eyes, you've got chaos. You got problems. And so these men, before they got off of this ship, they decided to develop this principle of governance where they all agreed that they would come together and establish laws and some system of order, and then they would all participate in that, and they would all yield to that, and they would all submit to that for the good of everybody who was involved. Now, many of these people who were on this ship were separatists. That is, they had come from England, and they were lovers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they had this desire to worship God according to the dictates of their own hearts. But the official religion in England, the Church of England, wouldn't allow them any variance from their own forms and standards. They had to do it like England said you had to do it. And they wanted to worship God with liberty. Could everybody say liberty? That's kind of the key word today, is liberty. That's what we're thankful for today, liberty and freedom. And so these separatists were looking for liberty as it relates to the worship of God. And since the Church of England would not permit this, they decided to seek liberty elsewhere. History records, this is not a contrived story on the part of Christians. I've read you the words, "In the name of God, amen, having undertaken for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith." These men and women took their children and got on this boat, sailed for 66 days, got to the shores of America, and they began to rebuild their lives in this new place so that they would have freedom to worship God according to the dictates of their own heart. And their own document, which they sat down together and hammered out. Now, I don't know if you've ever sat down with a group of people and tried to hammer out a document. It's not an easy thing to do. because everyone has their ideas and everyone has their input, and it's hard to get people to come to agreement on anything, but they were able to come with this document and all sign it and approve of it and agree to submissiveness to it, which says, as it begins, in the name of God, amen. And then having undertaken for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith, and then they spelled out what was on their mind. I think that's exciting, especially because today we're told that God didn't have anything to do with it, and love for God had nothing to do with it. And the documents I'm going to read to you this morning, straight from our history, say otherwise. Of course, in the course of time, other colonies were established beside this first one, and they grew and expanded until there were 13 altogether. But there was a great deal of tension between these New England colonies among themselves and England itself, the land from which they had come. If you know American history, you know there was war. There was disagreement until the leaders of these 13 colonies came together. They got together and penned what we know now as the Declaration of Independence. Now, 156 years had passed since the Mayflower Compact was signed. But now we come to a document that begins this way. In Congress, July the 4th, 1776. Does that date sound familiar to anybody? July the 4th, 1776. And I'm reading now right from the document, the unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America. These 13 colonies, 156 years after the beginning of the first one that established the Mayflower Compact, now they're growing and they're furthering their governmental structure. And it begins this way. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. In other words, we feel like we need to give an explanation of why we are withdrawing from England and why we're beginning a new country here. So notice the phrase that's on the screen there, the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and nature's God entitle them. I don't see any evolution or anything even closely resembling atheism in that. They recognized that there were laws of nature. How many of you know there are laws in nature? And they acknowledged right up front that the reason there were laws of nature was because there was a God, nature's God, who put them in motion. It was God who did what had been done. They acknowledged that. There are laws of nature and of nature's God. And these laws entitle humans, mankind, with certain things. So the next paragraph begins this way. And this is a statement I think that everybody in here has heard. It's been called probably the most notable sentence in U.S. history. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Have you ever heard that paragraph or that sentence before? Now, let's take just a moment, if we could, and let's take this sentence apart. This Declaration of Independence from England. It's already talked about the laws of nature and nature's God. It will talk about later in this sentence about the Creator. But notice how this begins. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Think about that sentence or that phrase. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Can I put that in just good old Wake County, North Carolina English? Even a dummy can understand this. That's what it says. These things are self-evident. It speaks for itself. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Anybody ought to be able to understand this, is what they were saying. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. First of all, I kind of want to focus on that word created. Created. Because created implies a... You guys are good. Created implies a creator, which he's spoken of later in the sentence. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Anybody ought to be able to understand this is so obvious, that all men are created equal and that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. When I look at that word, unalienable, I don't think I've ever said it in my life except in connection with this sentence. Probably you haven't either. But I look at the word, first of all, the root of that, alien. Alien speaks about something that doesn't belong. Alien is something that is different from what is here. It's something that doesn't belong. And then you put the un in front of it, and it's saying that these rights about which they speak, these are not alien rights. These are not different and weird things. These are the things that should be acceptable in this nation in which we are going to form here with this Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Rights that are right. They're true. It's just pretty obvious that this is the way it is. These are not weird things, different things, strange things. These are the way that the things that God has made. And among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now let's look at those for just a moment. Life. Why is it listed first? Because if you don't have life, the other two don't matter. Right? And another thing pops out at me when I read that. We hold these truths to be self-evident. It's pretty plain and pretty obvious, and anybody should be able to get this, they're saying, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life. Now, our forefather said that. That lets me know that the life of human beings was important to our forefathers. Am I right? However, if you look throughout America today, is life important in our culture today? Well, you say, well, yeah, it's important. We've got hospitals and we've got emergency rooms and we've got all kinds of places designed to preserve life. That much is true. But we've also got facilities that exist for the express purpose of ending the life of things that God has created. Are you with me? What do we call that? Absolutely. I think our forefathers would shudder at what is happening in our culture today based on what they said. There are certain things that the Creator has endowed us with, that among these are life. Do we know that God gives life? How dare man to take away life from a baby that God has given life to? That among these are life and liberty. Liberty is a wonderful thing. I'm going to read to you in a few moments that Jesus said that he came to bring liberty. Liberty is important to God. It's important to us. And then the pursuit of happiness. Wonderful things. I'm going to read it one more time because I'd like for us to get it, please. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. This is the beginning of the Declaration of Independence. About a year later, just over a year later, the leaders of this new nation hammered out another extremely important document. It's called the Constitution of the United States. Now follow this. The Mayflower Compact happened when the people came over and decided before they disembarked from the ship that they needed some sort of system of laws and governance. So they signed the Mayflower Compact. Then just a little while later, they came together. All the 13 colonies came together and signed this Declaration of Independence. We're no longer going to be associated with England. We are a new nation, the United States. And then about a year later, they came together and formed and hammered out this document, the Constitution of the United States. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. And this Constitution lays out how this government should work. This past week, I read the entire Constitution. I would suggest you do the same one day. Just read it all. That's the only way you'll know everything that's in it, if you read it. And then, after explaining how this government works, over a period of time, there are amendments that have been added to the Constitution. And the first one that I want to share with you today is the First Amendment. But before I get there, notice what's highlighted in blue. Blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity. You see, this question of liberty, this mini-series that we're grappling with now, is called Still Free. And today we are still free. 5 years from now, 10 years from now, we may not be still free. And the writers of this document were writing it to secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our children and our grandchildren. Because if it's not handled right by this generation, it may not be there for our children and grandchildren to handle it properly. So we have this responsibility, we have this obligation as citizens, as Christians, to be salt and light and to stand up and participate in this government that we call democracy. So the First Amendment is written, added to the Constitution. I'm going to read it to you now. The First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. Now let's take that for just a moment and work through it. The First Amendment says that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion. They had come from England where there was an official church, the Church of England. And because of that, and they came for religious freedom to worship God according to the dictates of their own heart, they said, that's not going to happen here in this country. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion. We have in our country come to call this First Amendment freedom of religion. How many of you ever heard that? In our country, we have freedom of religion. But this First Amendment has now morphed into something else, where no longer in our culture and in our day is it freedom of religion. It has been interpreted as freedom from religion. And all of those who are Christians now are being ridiculed and mocked and portrayed as being idiots in our culture for believing such a thing, and we have no right to force that on other people. Am I right? According to our culture, we need to keep quiet. We need to practice our faith to ourselves. Don't speak up. Don't stand up for Christ. Don't say anything that's controversial. Just mind your own business and keep your mouth shut as a Christian, and you'll be fine. That's what our culture is telling us. However, the First Amendment says this: Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Did you get that? We can practice, if you want to use the word religion, I don't like the word, but we can practice Christianity, and we can do it in America because we are still free. Now, you have some people who want to portray something different. You have some people who will tell us that if you do certain things and you talk about certain things from the pulpits of our churches in America, the IRS is going to take away your tax-exempt status. Have you ever heard that? And as I shared with you, I attended a meeting just a couple of weeks ago in which we were told by congressmen and people who are very aware of what's going on in this country, there has never been a church in the United States of America that has lost its tax-exempt status because of declaring what they believe. Not one. All it is a fear tactic. You Christians better be quiet. You Christians better not say anything. You Christians better not stand up for this and that and the other. If you do, we'll take your tax exempt status. And we were shown a document from the Internal Revenue Service with those things highlighted. And it said, and you may be subject to this, and you may be subject to that, and sent to churches. And if you say this, you may be in danger of losing your tax exempt status. And all it is a threat to churches and to pastors. And as this was explained, and then it was also explained to us that you have a right as a United States citizen to stand up for Christ, to stand up for the Word of God, to stand up for truth. And there has never been one single time in the United States where the IRS has taken away tax exempt status because somebody stood up for truth, the Word of God. And then they said, the group that was there explaining this to us as pastors, they said, and we have a list here of hundreds of pastors who are willing to handle your case for free should the Internal Revenue Service get involved in your affairs, because they know it's a threat. Listen, folks, it's the devil who is the father of lies. And we can't allow ourselves to sit around and be hoodooed by the wiles of the devil and the strategies of the devil and keep quiet about our faith and try to blend in the culture and never make any waves and never stand up for truth. The Lord expects us to stand up for Him and stand up for truth. We are here to be salt, and salt makes a difference. We are here to be light, and light shines in darkness. We're not here to keep our mouth shut and disappear into the woodwork and be like a chameleon. I remember it's probably been 30 years ago or more when my dad preached a sermon about a chameleon in one of our general assemblies. And he talked about the chameleon climbs up on a green tree and he turns green. The chameleon climbs down on the bark of the tree and he turns brown. He changes colors wherever he is. And that's what they're wanting Christians to do now, just to blend in and not be seen and not be heard. However, that's not the way that our forefathers envisioned this, because they were very plain concerning their faith. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people to assemble, peaceably to assemble, and to petition the government for redress of grievances. I want to say it one more time, folks. We're still free. we're still free. We don't have to believe the lies that are being perpetrated against Christians and churches and the IRS and all that. We don't have to be concerned about that. God is bigger than all of that. We just need to be faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ and be about the business of doing what He's called us to do. Now I'm going to read to you several quotes from different forefathers. George Washington expressed again and again his faith that he could trace the finger of providence through those dark and mysterious events that brought about this nation, that gave rise to the United States of America. George Washington believed that America was part of a divine plan of God. Again, George Washington said that he could trace the finger of providence through those dark and mysterious events that gave rise to this country. Thomas Jefferson said, "Can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we have removed their only firm basis, a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are the gift from God?" I love it. These men spoke, they spoke out. Thomas Jefferson, "Can the liberties of a nation be thought secure when we remove their only firm basis, which is a conviction in the minds of the people that these liberties are a gift from God?" George Washington said, "Of all the dispositions and habits which lead to political prosperity, religion and morality are indispensable supports." When I read that, in my mind, I see a stool with four legs. And if you remove a couple of those legs, what's that stool going to do? It's going to fall over. That's what George Washington was talking about. When you want to talk about political prosperity and things being done well and going smoothly, religion and morality are indispensable supports. Benjamin Franklin, in his Articles of Belief and Acts of Religion, listen to what he wrote. "We believe that there is one God, Father of the universe, that He is infinitely good, powerful, and wise, that He is omnipresent, that He ought to be worshiped by adoration, prayer, and thanksgiving, both in public and private, that He loves such of His creatures as love and do good to others, and will reward them either in this world or hereafter, that men's minds do not die with their bodies, but are made more happy or miserable after this life according to their actions." Then George Washington again said, "The smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal rules of order and right, which heaven itself has ordained." And then John Adams says, "Now I will avow that I then believed and now believe that those general principles of Christianity are as eternal and immutable as the existence and attributes of God, and that those principles of liberty are as unalterable as human nature and our terrestrial mundane system." Look how he equates principles of Christianity and principles of liberty. These are only the tip of the iceberg, so to speak, of the very straight and direct quotes from our forefathers concerning the great value that they themselves placed on Christianity and God and freedom of religion in this new government that they were putting together. That's all wonderful. I'm encouraged to read that. I think Christians need to know that. That as history is being rewritten in these days in which we live, and all of these things about God and Christianity that our forefathers talked about are being removed. Now we're told that the pilgrims didn't celebrate Thanksgiving with the Indians out of Thanksgiving. It was just a party. God and thankfulness are being removed. History is being rewritten. But the facts are the facts, and they're still there if we go back and read them. But what does the Bible have to say about liberty? In Luke chapter 4, verse 18, the Bible says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me." Do you remember when Jesus went into the synagogue? They handed Him the book to read. He opened it to the book of Isaiah. And then Jesus began to read this passage. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me." And later on in that verse it says, "to set at liberty those who are oppressed." To set at liberty those who are downtrodden. Now I know if you are like me, you've probably always attributed that liberty to a spiritual liberty. You know, we do that. Sometimes we take everything and just apply it to spiritual things. But how many of you know if you're oppressed and you're downcast and you don't have liberty, I'll use the word in the flesh, in society, how many of you know that affects you spiritually? Absolutely. So Jesus said that He comes to set at liberty those who are oppressed. He comes to set at liberty those who are downtrodden. And then finally, 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. And I believe our forefathers knew and understood this verse, where the Bible says, "Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty." They wrote the same thing in some of the quotes that I read to you this morning. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. I'm thankful today to be an American. Are you? I'm thankful for our heritage. I'm thankful for our forefathers, men who plainly spoke about God, who spoke about Christianity, who spoke about our responsibilities to live life in a way that are consistent with the revealed Word of God. It's an awesome thing to realize that. But we're not going to be told that by many people nowadays. That's why I was willing to take a Sunday morning and remind you of that, so that we understand from the Mayflower Compact to the Declaration of Independence to the Constitution of the United States of America to the First Amendment and the quotes of our forefathers from Jefferson, Washington, the first president, John Adams, the second president, and many others. They all spoke about these principles about which I'm speaking this morning. It makes me thankful. Would you stand with me? Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain. It's the next song, please. For purple mountain majesties, above the fruited plain, America, America, God shed His grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea. Stern impassioned stress, a thoroughfare for freedom be across the wilderness.
liberty in law. Oh, beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and
let's repeat that chorus.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above, from the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home sweet home. Could we pray together for America today? Lord, it is clear today in our minds, Lord, that you had something in mind by allowing and even bringing this nation into existence. We believed, Lord, that it was your plan. We thank you for those forefathers, those individuals who had such a burning desire in their hearts to commit their ways to you. They wanted religious freedom. They wanted to be able to worship you. They wanted to be able to praise you according to the dictates of their own hearts, and began to seek a place where they could do that. This country, Lord, is a result of their desires. And we pray today, Lord, that you would continue to help us still be free. Lord, help us to understand today that we cannot believe everything our culture throws our way and trying to convince us that we must be quiet. We must keep quiet. We must not say anything out loud. We must not wear our faith in a way that others can see it. We must keep it concealed. Lord, we can't talk about this and we can't talk about that. All of that is not true. And Lord, help us to understand that. Help us to return to your instructions to be the salt of the earth and to be the light of the world and to let our light shine so that others may see. Help us to open our mouths and declare the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to stand for righteousness, not to be afraid to speak up for what thus says the Word of God. Lord, help us to be that kind of people, as were our forefathers, who will take a stand for you and do what is right and speak up for the cause of Christ. Lord, we understand today. We understand that the church today, we're your voice in this world. Lord, we must proclaim the gospel. We must declare what it means to be holy. We must declare what it means to be obedient to your word. Lord, we must speak against sin. We must let people know what your word says. So give us the wisdom on how to do that, but then the boldness, Lord, to do it, not to be ashamed. For your word says, if we're ashamed of you, then you will be ashamed of us. And we certainly don't want that. So Lord, help us to live our faith, to live it unashamedly, to live it boldly, to live it out loud. Lord, to speak up for you and stand up and be counted in this great country that we call home. We ask that you do bless America and have your way in the lives of your people, Christians who love you. Lord, give us boldness to stand up. Lord, help us to get involved. Raise up a new generation of people, Lord, who are willing to run for office and get involved and make a difference and get plugged in to democracy, Lord, because you want to use your people. Help us to be willing to be used, we pray. Have your way. And yes, Lord, please bless America, for it is our home, sweet home, and we love it today. In Jesus' name, amen. While you still remain standing, Pastor Keith is coming to receive prayer requests today and to lead us into further prayer.